Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. I know it's been a long time since my last video and I'm so excited to be posting again. In today's tutorial, we are diving into something exciting. We're going to be building this infinite parallax carousel from scratch. So this tutorial is inspired by a previous video I made in Adobe XD where I showcased a parallax carousel effect. I wanted to create a step-by-step guide to bring that concept to life using HTML, CSS and pure JavaScript. So, let's get started. In my project, I've already created an index.html file as well as the style.css and the app.js files. I also have an images folder containing 6 different images that I'll be using for this tutorial. Feel free to use any images you like. Just make sure the width of the images you choose is larger than the height to achieve a smooth parallax effect. Now, I'll start by adding some boilerplate to our HTML. Inside the main tag, I'm adding a section tag with a class called Carousel. Inside this, I'm adding a div with a class called Carousel Slider. Next, let's add the images. For this, I'll be using a figure tag with a class called Carousel Slide. Inside this, I'll add a first image. Let me refresh the page here. Perfect. Now, let's go ahead and add the rest of the images in a similar way. With that, the HTML part is complete. As you can see, all the images are now displayed on the page. Next, to make it look like a proper carousel, we'll jump into the CSS and start styling. Alright, as usual, I'll start by resetting all the styles. What this does is, it clears all the default margins and paddings and sets the box sizing to a border box for consistent layout behavior. I forgot to link the CSS file in the HTML. I'll also link the app.js file so we are good to go for the JavaScript part later. Now, I'm going to start styling the carousel slide images. I'll give this a width of 28 and height of 50. I'm using view width because it helps make the images responsive to the screen size. Next, I'll set a max width and a max height to make sure the images don't get too large on bigger screens. I'm also adding an object fit cover to ensure the images fill their container without getting distorted. This keeps them looking clean and proportional. To give the images some rounded corners, I'll add a border radius of 18 pixels. Then, I'll also add a subtle box shadow for a bit of depth. Finally, I'll set object position 2550 to slightly shift the focus of the image for a more dynamic look and also add a transition to the object position and transform properties. We'll be animating these properties later. Now, to make this look like a carousel, we'll start styling the carousel slider class. First, I'll set display to grid. This makes it easier to lay out the items in a structured way. Next, I'll give it a height of 600 pixels. To center the content within the slider, I'll add place items center. Now, since we want the images to flow in a row, I'll use grid auto flow column. This ensures the grid items are laid out in a single horizontal line. For sizing each column, I'm setting grid auto columns such that it divides the width into 3 columns. Then, I'll set a gap of 20 pixels to add some spacing between each image for a clean layout. Finally, I'll add scroll behavior smooth. This will ensure smooth transitions when scrolling through the carousel later. The carousel layout is starting to take shape. Let's style the carousel class next. I'm giving this a max width of 1100 pixels and a width of 100%. I'm also setting the overflow to hidden so that the scroll bar is no longer visible. Great. Now let's vertically align the carousel to the screen. To do that, I'm going to target the main I'll add a display of grid, place item center, and height of 100 VH. Perfect. Now, to make the carousel images truly stand out, let's add a vibrant background using a linear gradient on the body. Alright, the styling is complete and the carousel is looking great. Now it's time for the fun part. Let's dive into JavaScript to bring this carousel to life and add some smooth animations to the cards when they're clicked. First, let's go ahead and target all the main elements we'll be working with. I'll be selecting the carousel and carousel slider with the query selector and the carousel slides with the query selector all. Now that we have access to the main elements we'll be working with, let's define an animation config object to hold some of the key configuration values. Here, time is the animation duration in milliseconds and visible slides will be the number of slides visible at once. Next, I'll also add a helper function called mod. This function ensures that even when the index goes negative or beyond the number of slides, it wraps around properly. Now let's create a function to handle the setup of our carousel. Let's call this function generateCarousel. Inside this, first I'll calculate how much each slide should move to fit the visible slides. Here, move distance determines the percentage of the carousel that each slide should occupy based on the number of visible slides. Next, I'll get the total number of slides by using carouselSlides.length, and I'll initialize a current index variable to keep track of the active slide to 0. Now, before proceeding with any other logic, we need to check if the number of slides is less than the number of visible slides. If that's the case, we can just return because there's nothing to loop through. Next, I'll use a for loop to iterate through the visible slides. We'll use this loop to clone some slides at the beginning and end of the slider to create a seamless looping effect. So here's what's happening. In each iteration, I'm cloning one slide from the end of the original slides and adding it to the beginning using prepend. Similarly, I'm cloning one slide from the beginning and appending it to the end using append. This ensures the carousel feels infinite when we scroll. Let's call the generateCarousel function and change the overflow of the carousel to scroll. As you can see, we have cloned the first three cards to the back and last three cards to the front. Great. Next, let's add an animation function to handle the carousel's movement. Here, ms is the duration of the animation and it defaults to the value we set in our animation config. Then, I'll calculate the current index position using the modulo function we defined. This ensures the current index wraps around correctly even if we go out of bounds. Now, to animate the slider, I'll set the transition duration dynamically. And then, I'll update the transform property to move the slider. I'm using translate x to shift it horizontally based on the current index. Here, the calculation ensures the slider moves the right amount while accounting for the clone slides we just added. Next, I'll loop through each slide to check if it's active and apply styles accordingly. If the current index is out of bounds but the slide is active, I'll reset its scale back to 1. I'll also toggle a class called LastActive based on whether the slide is currently active. This lets us easily style the active slide and apply animations. Now let's define the navigation methods to control the carousel. These functions will allow us to move to a previous slide, the next slide, or even jump to a specific slide. I'll start with the prev function, which will handle moving to the previous slide. First, I check if the current index is less than or equal to -1. If it is, I return early because we can't go back further. Otherwise, I decrement current index by 1. Then, I call the anim function to update the carousel's position. Similarly, let's define the next function for moving forward. Here, I check if current index is greater than or equal to total slides. If it is, I stop here to prevent moving beyond the last slide. Otherwise, I increment current index by 1. Then I call anim again to move the slider. Finally, I'll create a goto function, which lets us jump to a specific slide. If the index is next immediate slide, that is current index plus 1, we don't need to do anything, so I return. If the index is less than or equal to the current index, it means we are moving backwards. So I call the previous function. Otherwise, I call next to move forward. Perfect. With these navigation methods, we now have the tools to control the carousel programmatically. Next, we can hook these up to some buttons or gestures for user interaction. In this tutorial, I'll be moving the carousel by clicking on the images. But if you wanted, you could easily add buttons to navigate it to the left or right using the previous and next functions. Now let's add some interactivity by allowing users to click on the images to navigate the carousel and handle transitions properly. First, I'll create a function to add click listeners to all the images. Here, I'm selecting all the image elements inside carousel slide. Next, I loop through each image using a for each. For each image, I'm adding a click event listener, and when the image is clicked, the goto function is called with the adjusted index, that is index -3, to account for the extra clone slides at the beginning. This allows the users to jump to a specific slide by clicking its image. Now let's handle the transition behavior when the carousel reaches the boundaries. I'm adding a transition end event listener to the carousel slider. This event fires whenever the CSS transition finishes. Inside this listener, I'll check if the current index has moved out of bounds. That is, if current index is less than -1, it means we have moved before the first slide. So I'll reset it to the last slide and set reset to true. Similarly, if current index exceeds the total slides, I'll reset it to 0 and set reset to true. If a reset is needed, I'll instantly reapply the position without any animation. Then I'll call add image click listeners again to rebind click events on the updated slide elements. Finally, I'll call anim function with a value of 0 to ensure the initial setup positions the carousel correctly without animation, even before the user interactions begin. This guarantees the carousel starts in the right place and resets smoothly during transitions. Great. Now you can see the carousel is functioning as expected.
Nice.
But there's still a few things missing. We want to center the image to stand out more by highlighting it. And we also want a parallax-like effect when the slides move. To achieve this, we'll add some more styles to our CSS. First, I'll use the sibling selector to scale up the image immediately following the active one. This increases the size of the next slide, giving it a more prominent look. Next, we'll adjust the object position of the image inside this highlighted slide to make the parallax effect noticeable. This centers the image within the slide, creating the illusion of movement as carousel animates. As you can see, the carousel is working beautifully. The images slide smoothly, the center image is highlighted with a scaling effect, and the parallax style movement really adds to that extra polish to the design. I hope you found this tutorial helpful and that it inspires you to create something amazing. If you have any questions, suggestions, or just want to share your version of this carousel, feel free to drop a comment below. And don't forget to like and subscribe for more tutorials like this. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Happy coding!